Blog Talk Radio.
When you need help or advice, you turn to your parents or a trusted friend for help. So why go outside of Virginia, your home, when you need car insurance? Abra Insurance gives you individual attention and won't turn you away no matter what your driving record looks like. Giving same-day personal service in the state of Virginia for over 30 years. Abra Insurance, 979-0814 is the number. AbraInsurance.com is the site.
They forgot about you, 50. They forgot about you.
50? We ain't forgot.
What?
Paid when I made 80 mil.
Okay.
Jimmy got paid. I ain't even got the rap. Now life is made. Since I ain't even got the rap, I'm still getting my age.
What you doing, Patty? What you doing, Patty? That's what Patrick Mahomes doing right now, laughing straight to the bank. Let's jump right into it, man. We jump into the shit straight. Hey, analysts, if you want to call in, 760-695-1106. The number is 760-695-1106. We're getting right into it. Shout out to my guy. Who say that? Shiznae says, I don't want to curse too much. You know what I'm saying? I know a lot of my, you know, university followers don't realize your boy got a potty mouth. I do curse. You know what I'm saying? 540 caller, you unmuted. Whenever you want to talk, you going to talk because we're talking money. And don't be surprised if you hear some music cut you off because I'm in that type of bag today.
So what you talking about money? What money you talking about? Real money or Monopoly money?
Man, we talking. Hey, hold on. We got Robert on the line. Robert C. Green, that real money. What's good with you, fam?
I'm good, man. How are you doing?
Man, you know, I'm awesome. You know, I get excited when contracts come into play. You know, this is what I live for. I love to talk contracts.
Well, I got a last conversation. I am 1,000% a proponent of going forward that no contract should be over 2 years in the NFL. It sounded good when it put out and the way everything was written out, but the media, and obviously, again, when you say 10 years, we go into that term extension again, so that makes it 12. And then based off of what it is, in plain English, Patrick Mahomes will have to play 8 years before he's making what Russell Wilson is making today per average. So you have backload, you have team incentives like Super Bowl champion, NFC championship, AFC championship. You have, league MVP, Pro Bowl. A lot of that stuff is out of your hands. And then when you talk about how it backs up going down, what he did do was allow the Kansas City Chiefs by doing 10 years to allow them to go after the Super Bowl for the next 2 or 3 years, to keep some of their core players there, to repay them. Like, they got Chris Jones right now. So that massive extension, that's what it is. But there's no way that literally you're talking about a contract that's worth $503 million as a total, but $140 million guaranteed that you can look yourself in the mirror and say that's good. Like I said, I had to get the full numbers of it. That's some expensive paper for the other $400 that's not fully guaranteed. Now, it only takes one injury, too, to change all of that. And so, like I said, again, when you talk about guys like Ezekiel Elliott and now Patrick Mahomes, when a team basically puts you in a 10-year deal, that's not for you. That's not in your best interest. That's the team's best interest. Like anything else, you have a certain amount of time to basically maximize your ability. By giving that team 12 years, they have all leverage going forward. They don't have to do anything at this point forward. So what they did initially was to try to jump it forward. Oh, yeah, you're going to be making the same amount of what these other guys are making. But like I said, 8 years before you can meet Russell Wilson. But if you say $140 million guaranteed, fully guaranteed, well, we know Kirk Cousins, Matt Ryan, Aaron Rodgers, and a couple others are going to pass $140 million total made probably by next year. That's the facts. I always say trust the facts, not the process. So when they threw those numbers out there talking about how these things work, like he basically gave the Chiefs, and so now his agency is going to say, oh, look what I did. I got a guy, $503 million contract. No, you didn't. But no kid is going to really research that. He's going to be, it's just Patrick Mahomes, league MVP, $503 million. Again, and the NFL is the only job and sport in America where people can throw out numbers that literally are not what they are. And yet their union and them continue to look at this paper and sign it, and it really doesn't amount to anything. I mean, it's a great deal as far as the stance of getting $140 million, but just give me my $140 million. Don't give it to me for 12 years. Give it to me for five. If I'm average is $37 million a year, what quarterbacks are making, I'm the league MVP, Super Bowl champion, face of the league, give me $40 million a year. Give me 5 years, $200 million, call it a day. If it works out, we go forward. If not, we don't. That's real money. That's what he's really looking at. He's not looking at no $503 million under that contract.
There you go. You heard it from Robert T., the man with the money. 10 years. Look, when I saw the 10 years too, bro, I was taken aback.
Sorry.
Well, my fault. 12 total. Yeah,
we do the real numbers on here. We don't do the reporting. Then we do the real stuff. 12 years.
Yeah, he signed a 2-year deal. So here's a fun fact with this contract that folks need to pay attention to. This will really blow your mind. A dude like Ryan Tannehill got a better fully guarantee at his signing than versus Patrick Mahomes.
Yep.
I know people are looking at the longevity, but in all that contract, it's a lot of if on the roster. And everybody assuming that he will be on the roster, but it just lets you know that they got all the power. So, yes, it's $500 million total. Yes, this is due at signing. Yes, he could get $60 million in 2027. That season alone is worth $60 million, but they have all the control, all of it. And that's what myself and Robert T. were talking about. It's like they had the nerve to bring up Mike Trout contract in the MLB. Why would y'all do that? Why?
Because his is all guaranteed. Every dollar, every year. Unless he goes become a drug dealer, he gonna get that. Even if he hurt himself, he getting that.
Yeah. My man Marvelous said he was $104 million by March 21st. That Patrick Mahomes.
Right. So the one good thing in this is that is what they did was, so for example, in 2021 or 2023, I believe. So basically, his 2025 salary is fully guaranteed once he hits 2023. So basically, the money that's backloaded, once he gets to that certain year, then they gotta guarantee that next couple of years. But again, you don't know if he's going to get to that point. But the point I was making, too, right now is that Aaron Rodgers' current contract at 36, after being in the league, is 4 years, $134 million. And he had $98 million guaranteed. So if you say you got a 12-year deal and you got $140 million guaranteed, Aaron Rodgers signed one for four for $134 with $98 guaranteed, but the likelihood of him getting all $134 is great because it's only 4 years. I'm just looking at his career earnings right now. Because I said before, Kirk Cousins is going to end up being higher than everybody because Aaron Rodgers is like 35 right now.
Yeah.
But like I said again, if you just break it down, so if you do four times three is 12. So if Aaron Rodgers got $134 for 4 years, you do that times 12, does his contract not exceed or basically meet the same one as Patrick Mahomes but fully guaranteed? $134 million times four. That's over $503 million.
Yeah.
My math's not off.
I'm just doing comparative
right now.
Yeah, and the thing is, like, everybody understands, like, when you talk about a sports show and you talk about being an analyst, you got to, like, overanalyze it. So I know a lot of folks like, God damn, man, he getting all this money, why are we worried about this? This is what we do. Like, you break down the contract and break it down in layman's terms. So, yes, the working man and working woman, I was just going to say, he getting millions. We understand that. But we're breaking down the contract because another thing that jumped out to me is 31% of Mahomes' contract is guaranteed. That's the smallest percentage among active $25 million plus a year contracts. The smallest percentage. So even though he got this 12-year, $500 million contract, he has the smallest percentage guaranteed money. So when they keep throwing around – he's scheduled to make X, Y, Z this year. And then he's scheduled to make this X, Y, Z this year. That's not a guarantee. So, yes, like my man Marvelous said, he getting $100 million by a certain date. And we applaud that. We love that. But they still have the rights to, like, he can't move about.
Yeah, he's going to get that regardless. After that 140, they could literally say, we don't want you anymore. Aaron Rodgers is going to be in that same spot like 2 years from now if they wanted to. They can get out from underneath it. Once that 140 is paid, it's 140. But that's the team control. The team can say and dictate, yo, we need to make some changes. Oh, you're not playing as well. You're coming off an injury. They can say all types of things. So we are assuming that Patrick Mahomes is going to stay on this ascending level all the way through. But the reality is they can also say, you know what, we're going to change up our whole offense. We're going to go to become a running team now. We're going to become the Tennessee Titans.
Hmm.
It's a possibility. It's happened before. It happens to every athlete we know in the league that when the team want to move away from you, they start telling you things like, we need to see if this rookie can play next year. The GMs come and tell you, you didn't produce like you did last year. You're a pass rushing defensive lineman or a pass rushing specialist. All of a sudden, they run a lot of two-gap schemes, or now they dropping you into the flat. You ain't getting those numbers up. Patrick Mahomes is going to hand the ball off, Patrick Mahomes inside the five-yard line, he got a $2 million bonus incentives for like 30-plus touchdowns. All of a sudden, you think it's by accident they coordinated calling runs inside the three-yard line or inside the 10 the whole time. Bruh, this is business. Because it happens every single time, no matter who you are. And that's what players don't get. So when you get into a contract that's incentive-based in a team sport, not baseball, hit 400 home runs, you know, then you get this, hit that. Okay, I'm in control of that. I don't make the call to the plays. I don't. So they can do a whole lot of things with that contract to make those numbers that they see not appear. And it's going to be really hard for them to make it appear. Especially because, as you know, in football, you can say all you want about, you're going to get better, you're going to hit your prime. Man, there's so many things that happen to your body and longevity and staying focused that the odds are against him to really even be able to maintain what he did the first 2 years, much less another 12.
Yeah.
The
thing folks got to realize is this is a fickle damn sport, and fans, y'all fickle too. So while everybody's, congratulatory of Patrick Mahomes and say he worth every penny, blah, blah, blah. If he had one or two bad seasons, them same fans could be like, man, he ain't worth that damn money. He got over on the cheese. Like, that's why sometimes it's like, that's why we do this, because we know it's a revolving door. Everybody changes their stance. Seem like every damn day, every week. So right now, yes, Patrick should get his money. Like, my main thing is Patrick deserves the money, but why 10 years? Why 10? That's a long-ass time. 10 years. 10. When 12. Donovan McNabb signed that, 12. Okay. He signed 12, and people say, I've never seen a quarterback sign for 12 years. I was like, y'all remember Donovan McNabb signed 12 years with the goddamn Eagles? We forget that quick. Y'all remember Michael Vick signed 10 years, $130 million with the Falcons? Everybody got excited. And then he signed for another $100 million with the Eagles. Ask Mike if he ever saw a total of $100 million from either. Well, I know what happened with the Falcons. But with the Eagles, did he see that $100 million? That's why I always say, stop looking at that big-ass number. Stop.
I got a big number for you, Hawk. So check this out. So right now, Aaron, so we're talking about comparatives. Like, you like to do this a lot of time. So if Patrick Mahomes, 12 more years, he's been in the league now. He'd have been in the league 3 years, so it'll be 15 years when they get this deal done. So with that deal done, whatever it may be from there, 140 guarantees. So Aaron Rodgers has played 15 years already. His total right now in 15 years is $219 million. But he's under contract for 21 and 22 and 23. He still has a $21 million, $22 million, $25 million, and $25 million. Another $100 million over the next 4 years. So that's putting him at 18 years at approximately almost $319 million. So at the end of the day, real money about what it is and what they're talking about, how this guy got to play 8 more years to get where Russell Wilson is now. From a base standpoint. That's hard. That's hard. So Aaron Rodgers is literally going to likely come away with that 319. Patrick Mahomes is basically guaranteed 140.
Yeah,
that's
as of today.
That's 2.5 times the amount.
As of today.
The same amount of time.
40, as of today. So I'm not worried about the 500. We're not worried about what's going to happen in 2027. As of today.
Yeah, 140.
40 is the number that we paying attention to, because that's what they don't want you to pay attention to. That's the truth.
Exactly. 140 real, another 320-something, like, imaginary.
They keep throwing up the $500 million. $500 million, unprecedented. The richest contract in sport. And I'm like, can we just focus on Mike Trout? Can we focus on Bobby Bonilla? Can we focus on those type of contracts? Because they get theirs regardless. Like, they try to get us with that damn comparing it to Mike Trout contract. They got to stop that. There's a lot of rolling guarantees. You remember the Steelers tried to do that with Le'Veon Bell and everybody got mad? They didn't understand what a rolling guarantee was. They were like, oh, look, all this money's guaranteed. He's dumb. Okay.
Yeah. Well, like when we do the business shows, but I get a lot of people don't really want to focus on it. Because, again, I get it. Cause when you're making a whole lot of money, it's like, well, I ain't making it. What do I really care?
Yeah.
But the fact is, when you talk about market value and how certain people get certain things done, that either you feel like they are better than what they do to somebody else versus someone who's not as good, but yet then mm-hmm. you try to turn around and you think that's the agent that's actually doing it. When it's not, it's just basically the timing of it. So when people want to say, well, he was never the player that Joe Montana was, well, that's the point. This is not the time that Joe Montana was playing. He led the way, but you don't have to be Superman these days to get certain things. It's the market value, what the business entails. You have to know your worth, and if you don't know your worth, then you're going to end up looking crazy regarding these things. So, again, comparative right now, again, we're still on this, Kirk Cousins in his eighth year. So, and again, all things being equal, Kirk Cousins in his 8 years already, made $100 million, but under these next three contracts, I mean, his next 2 years, he has another 40, 21, and $35 million coming, which he's going to get. He's going to get it. So with that being said, if his 11th year, he done made about $190 million. So he's already, again, like I said, he passed Patrick Mahomes. He's not a league MVP. He's not a Super Bowl champion.
Nope.
He ain't even won a playoff game, I don't think.
Nope. Who is that?
So, like I said, the real – and again, what numbers that I just mentioned, that's real money in hand. That's real money in hand.
Yeah, and this takes me back to the same folks who's looking at the Last Dance documentary. And was saying, man, it's messed up, man. They should have known. You got to come back and renegotiate with Scotty, man. Why the hell would Scotty sign that? Because back then, when Scotty signed this contract, that joint looked real sweet. And then within 3 years, it ain't look so sweet. We don't know when the new contract negotiation is going to start. In like 2 years, 3 years?
I mean, when that new money? His would probably be like five. They're not coming back no time. So they need the salary cap room. So they couldn't even touch it if they wanted to.
Okay.
They were the 32nd ranked salary cap ranked team in the league. So basically, they got some receivers. They got the rookie running back. But then you got Travis Kelce. I don't know when his deal coming up. You got Chris Jones on defense. So they basically a franchise tag. They got Frank Clark. So they got a bunch of guys. They're going to try to make a run. They got the Honey Badger. They don't got cheap guys. So they needed all the salary cap, and they didn't have Patrick Mahomes signed yet either. So, again, when I talk about that deal, whether people say, oh, it's great, nah, that's a really, really
team-friendly deal. Yes, a team-friendly deal. And Patrick, on record saying that he wasn't going to try to break the bank and kill the salary cap for his team. So you understand why this deal is made after he said what he said, too. Because he said it.
Which is his decision, as long as he understand that.
Yeah, it's his decision, which, look, I don't want folks thinking me and Rob are like saying Patrick Mahomes dumb, or his agent is dumb. We're just saying, when you really look at the contract, this is what it is. We're applauding him for signing this deal. We know it's a huge deal. We understand what it entails as far as in the future, like each year, like the roster bonus and what money follows and things like that. We're just saying that we would want to see players have more control of the money upon signing versus the team having all the leverage. Because the team still has the leverage.
That's what people got to understand. That's what they got to understand. When they say players aren't worth a certain amount of money, people, again, it goes back to the NCAA. Without the players, none of this exists. And it's not just a football game. These contracts, these players that are playing are paying different different jobs across the world, whether it's FanDuel or the coaches or the commentators or the TV advertising or the vendors, they're all following behind what these guys do on the field. But the reality is most guys don't realize how short this career can be, how fast it can end. And just believe, when owners give that amount of money, they only give it when they make at least 3 to 4 times the fold. They don't go backwards. The same way, like when now the NFL is making so much money, compared to where it used to be. But somehow the union figured that 32 billionaire owners should be getting 52% over 1,900 less than millionaires, and the split be 52% to 48%. Who negotiated that? I'm splitting with 32 people. We splitting with 1,900, and we have a lesser percentage, and our bodies are the ones at risk in a shorter term, as we draft for cheap labor every year. So when you're talking about business and knowing your worth, it's like they don't make any business sense. Only in football where that will fly up to this point, which I'm working diligently to change that. Because I just said to you, there's nobody else in America on the planet that got God-given common sense will go to their job and say, yeah, I'm going to do all the work, I'm going to take all the risk, and then I'm going to take less of the reward.
Darren, you off mute, and I think that's Vaughn. Vaughn, that's you. You off mute, too. 404. I think that's Vaughn. I know that's Darren.
Yeah, what up?
What up, baby?
Yeah.
What's your thoughts on this Patty Mahomes money making deal?
All right. First of all, you're not gonna let me go, and then I'm not seeing my slogan, because you know, this for the brothers up north getting full of that Jack Mac.
That Jack Mac.
First smack back, you got a nigga to back smack, and y'all gonna love it. You know, hey, listen, man. Hey, you know what I'm saying. My guy Lux is battling this weekend. I'm happy. You know, I'm glad you got Rob to break it down, because I was looking at this contract. Like I text you, I was like, yo, like, this thing kind of hurt my head with me looking at it, because I was like, there's no way. I was like, the 477 mechanisms, that was the thing that was getting me, and nobody's asking about it. I'm like, you're not telling me it's guaranteed. Like, what do mechanisms even mean?
Mechanism.
You know what I mean? Mean like incentives, like all things that can happen. That, like I said, Super Bowl, playoffs, MVP of the league, most passing yards in the league, touchdowns, stuff like that.
Mechanism.
Code word. Exactly.
That's solid a lot, because I just be like, man, fully. That's the only guarantee I look for is fully.
Hey, man. But if I just hit on two points real quick. The first one, yeah, the NFLPA ends up signing bad deals, but you got to be honest about what they're bringing to the table as far as negotiation. The biggest issue is you got a sport that has a really short span for you to play, and then within that fight, you got what? You got basically an upper tier of payment. You got a mid-class tier payment and a lower-class tier payment. So those people can be divided during negotiation time. And before you know it, a strike, you know, they fold real quick, because some dudes are like, man, I only got possibly 3 years to make this bread. Let's get this season going. So you taking that hand to play against the owners when you're trying to negotiate, and basically you get in that spades game with no spades. So they get beat every time, because – they need that upfront money so bad. So it's a tough thing, man. What's my man? Dominique Foxworth has kind of talked about this a couple of years ago. He was saying they should just get rid of the NFLPA and try some other kind of way of figuring out.
We've already done that. I mean, me personally, that's why I talk about all the time. Like, the PA doesn't make – I say something like this. You're a first-round pick, you're a seventh-round pick. The dues are the same. $18,000 a year per dues. Again, when I explained, the NFLPA doesn't do anything for the seventh-round pick like you would do for the first-round pick for those dues. At the same time, you'll say, okay, we're representing you, but you get, what, a Madden check, you get some Fanatic cards, and again, it ends up being like a $700 check, but you pay $18,000. The fact is that most players that in the seventh round don't play the 3 years, because normally what they do is they don't want to pay your benefits. They don't want you to become vested after 3 years. So they rotate from that. But no, but I tell players that from the get-go, if you're a seventh-round pick, undrafted free agent. But with the players, the union don't tell the players, too. Even if the players opt out of paying their union dues, they still got to be represented. But you mentioned, you said the middle tier. There's no more middle tier in the NFL, and that's where the things hit the rubber meets the road. The education is basically the guys that look like they're making a whole lot of money. That's who the NFL puts their money behind, so those guys never really complain. But to their credit, this year, when they did the vote just barely passed to go in, a lot of the high pay guys basically voted no, even though the lower tier guys didn't realize it was against their own best interest. Because in the same, like I said, the next 3 years from now, those guys are not going to realize how bad of a deal that was for them. But the same way the last CBA, there were players that signed that didn't realize that their benefits and stuff will be dictated by guys who come into the league who don't even know who they are. So now they lost their benefits.
Yeah.
So you don't look
right.
to PA
right, right.
convince you to sign on things that you need to do for your own life.
Right, right. Let me finish this last point. And that's why you see a lot of the veterans or former players kind of upset because some of the benefits they lost based on this new deal. And then the other thing is this. If we go back a few years, if you remember when they said, well, you know what, the rookies are making all the money. If we get rid of this idea, it'll spread more money to the veterans. But the exact opposite happened. They put in the rookie wage scale to where the money is slotted, and then what? The league got younger. They cutting people
right.
earlier. Some of the people who we know should still be playing in the league are no longer in the league unless they're coming in for the low. So that con game is being ran. As far as Pat Mahomes, he got as much money as he could possibly get from the Chiefs, but you're basically saying, I'm going to dive into it. It's like the Scottie Pippen deal. You're getting long-term security at the risk of missing out on what the new TV deals are, what new revenue streams come in. So it's a big risk, but it's secure in that sense. I wouldn't have done it, but, you know.
Yeah, that's kind of crazy because that was the first thing I asked. I said, well, if he's getting this much money, how are they going to pay anybody else? And that's like I said, when Hawk kind of showed me the breakdown of everything, and then he sent me the – who was the guy that you sent me, Hawk, this morning? It was top football, the white guy.
Yeah. Oh, man. I did you a lot of stuff, but let me – I think it was Florio.
Was it Florio?
Hold on.
And I'm like,
I
okay.
Can check.
Okay.
Keep going.
That was my main thing, man. I was like, it was like a 10-year contract. I mean, you may see those like in baseball. That's all guaranteed money. Like, just for that to be for football, I was like, man, this don't – I mean, it sounds good, and it may sound good how the media try to blow it up, but it just didn't make sense to me. But like I said, thank you to Rob for kind of breaking everything down. And I'm guessing – so what you're trying to say is, I guess, all of this is just based on his success, basically.
Now. But it's not just that. It's off-the-field stuff, too. He's the face of the league now.
The
Lamar Jacksons and Deshaun Watsons.
Yep.
He's getting paid to basically that extra money, you want to call it that. He's going to have to be doing a lot of promos, a lot of TV ads, and all those different things. Yep. So, but the Patrick Mahomes deal did, though, it did. And, again, I don't know if we – to all the Cowboys fans that are listening with your show, Hawk, that they just really screwed Jerry Jones over six ways sideways because all he got to do is continue to do what he do. The bottom line is Dak shouldn't sign no 10-year deal. Jerry wish Dak would come and sign a 10-year deal because that's the point. Like, no, I'm not doing that because it's the opposite. What Patrick Mahomes just did for the Chiefs is allowing – so when you say pay all that money, it's not paying all that money. It allows other people to get paid throughout that time frame and other positions by him doing it for so long. By Dak getting a one-year franchise tag, he has $31 million this year, and they don't get him signed by July 15th. The next year franchise tag, they don't get a deal, it's going to be like $40 million. So it goes up as a quarterback in their actual situation, way up. So therefore, he can end up getting that next deal, and then at the same time, he can still go out there and then sell himself to where, like Le'Veon Bell did, whoever got the most money in the salary cap that they have to spend. There are certain teams that have to spend a certain amount of money. They don't have to spend it every year, but by a four-year window, they have to spend that money. So team players look for teams that they have to. So when Le'Veon Bell left Pittsburgh, why signed with the Jets? The Jets suck. Well, Jets had the most money in that salary cap. But then, why he didn't show up for OTAs? Because he's trying to get residency in Florida, where he lived at.
Mm-hmm.
You don't want to get all that money and go to the Jets before the 6 months in one day, because New York will take everything you got, and then some. So I'm going to do this at home. Yeah, so it's like, it's all business all the way through. And for people that try to vilify these actual athletes, like I said, I'm not knocking Patrick Mahomes, because he's making a decision that I want to be the face of the league. They was looking for, since we know Brady's at the end right now, it was going to be one of those three guys, like probably Lamar, Deshaun, possibly, and Patrick Mahomes. Patrick Mahomes got the league MVP and the school MVP. It was done.
Mm-hmm.
That's how this league works. It ain't again, he had no off-the-field issues. So they're going to make him look like, so when they say $500 million, they saying that, hey, follow what he do. Even though it's not real, now everybody going to follow every word with Patrick Mahomes say. Patrick Mahomes said the sky's falling. Anybody's an NFL fan, they're going to say the sky's falling. So people
okay, so Rob, I got to.
But let me add one more thing. Here's the issue with long-term deals, though. What are we on right now? iPhone 11? Okay, what are we going to be on in 10 years? We watch TV right now. Most people cut the cord. What are you going to be watching as far as TV, and how is TV going to work in 10 years? We have no idea. That's the trouble with signing on with something like that for 10 years. You don't know how much the world is going to change. You don't know how much more revenue may come in. Maybe the league gets bigger globally as opposed to just being the National League. Like, you don't know. So that's the issue with signing the deal that he did. And here's the other part. All those escalators and all that stuff that they talked about, remember this. Pat Mahomes exercises any of those options, all everybody is going to remember is $500 million. The fans are going to turn on him. It'll get ugly for him. And the money will be used as a weapon now for him to always opt in, take the ownership side. And look, like I said, long-term security, he got what he wanted. But there's a whole lot of, you know, devils in those details.
Really, contracts are really 1 year in the NFL. Anybody that plays in the NFL knows that. So even if you were, take for example the guy Shaq Barrett, who had 19 sacks last year, he on the franchise tag right now. Why is that? Because he wasn't one of the first round players. He out of Tampa Bay. He's with the Denver Broncos sometime. He had the good years with the Broncos, and he went over there with. But he had 19 sacks. Oh, that means you should get paid, right? Do it again. Or if you're not one of those guys who is well known that the whole league knows that they can't use branding and marketing and things like that, he wasn't a top draft pick, you still won't get it. So you can't even say it's about production. Because, like I said, you could take a look no further than Cam Newton. He went to the Patriots with an incentive-based $7 million deal. So it's like the reality is that you got everything is 1 year. You kill it that year, and you're going to franchise you, Shaq. Get that franchise tag, take it. Do it again next year. That's the only way you really get paid your money is each and every year. That's it. And that's what players are trying to realize. Like you sign these five or six
So when
deals.
You ball out, they say we don't pay for past production.
Exactly.
And then when you're on the cusp and you got potential, they say, well, we can't pay you because you haven't done anything. So, you know, there's always a con to it, man. But, yeah, it's 1 year.
So if you do it for 1 year, then you can decide. Hey, nobody mentioned his name again. Darrell Revis, that's what he did. You know, that's why they don't talk about him. Because he's like, a mercenary for hire.
He was so good he flipped the game and they couldn't do nothing about it.
Yeah, because he's like, all right, y'all don't want to pay me this year. I'm going to go to the team that got the salary cap in the great corner. I'm going to go over here. I'm fine.
Hey, I got a question.
Playing everywhere.
Do y'all feel like KC fans were really turning the kid that brought them a Super Bowl?
Hey, man, how long
have you been in
America? How long you been in America, man?
I know, because my buddy Gabe, who lives in Kansas City fan, was there when I was with the Chiefs, my home. That's my dog. He said KC fans won't turn on him at all. He loved in KC. He brought a Super Bowl and a winning attitude. So I got to throw the question out there, like,
What's prime time tell y'all, man? They fans. They only blow when you're hot. So right now, he's untouchable. He's that dude. But let you have a couple of up and down seasons. Let you have an injury season where you miss some time. Let some things come out that aren't so MAGA-like as far as what you say and what they think about you. It can change on anybody, man. Ask LeBron James. At one point, that dude was the hero. Couldn't be touched. Now look at him. You know what I'm saying?
Well, that's a whole other story. Don't start down that rabbit hole.
5-4-0-7.
You know?
Yeah, I got a question though. So what does this do for, like, I guess, so if Lamar Jackson comes out, say for example, and he balls out again?
Let me go ahead and throw that. I'm gonna be that guy. I'm gonna tell the truth. His ass not getting the type of contract because he too high risk because he run around. We all know that.
Yeah, I'm about to say that's never gonna happen. He's still too close to the urban side for that to happen too.
And all this stats of him running around and stuff, they're gonna use that against him come contract time. I hate to be that guy. Let's just jump out there.
It's also a media based thing too. Lamar, again, people keep, when they make comparisons about these guys, about their play on the field, again, I'm going to say it again, the NFL is a business. Patrick Mahomes got paid a lot more so as the NFL officially, along with the Chiefs, saying he's the face of the league without saying it. That is it. That they were telling y'all, like, all right, Brady's done. It is now Patrick Mahomes. We're in a situation with racism across the country. Patrick Mahomes is white and black. NFL, again, from the NFL standpoint, they figure, well, let's do that. We want to sing the black national anthem or whatever they want to call it. They're going to do anything they can to try to stop the bleeding. Like,
that was
going to
be my next question. I was going to say, if he was the same color.
So because Patrick Mahomes is mixed, hold on, because Patrick Mahomes is mixed is the only reason. Because he's black and white.
No.
Did you just say that?
Oh, here we go.
I'm saying the NFL, the owners look at it that, again, if you're talking about picking a quarterback as your face, that's exactly the reason. They're trying to step on nobody's toes anymore. They just say, well, he's white and he's black.
Hold on, man. The top quarterback in the NFL never said that.
Think of it like a sweet potato pie. You cut up your sweet potato pie, race is a factor, his talent is a factor, his age is a factor, his accomplishments are a factor. All of that comes into play to where what? You make him the friend, you know, the face
that's
of
it.
The league.
That's what I said. It's never just one thing.
No, you said it correctly, but I'm saying he took your words the wrong way and tried to say you were saying he was only getting it because of that. It's like, no, it's about the
NFL is a business. So, again, the guys that they use is all encompassed in what they make the decision to do those things. That contract would not sign without the blessing of the NFL. I guarantee it. I don't want to change the topic, but again, since it's Pride Month, I tell people this story. And I said this to you, Ahmad, about Michael Sam when he first got drafted. And I said that the only way he wasn't going to make the team because he was – the way the league works is that he went to school in St. Louis, and that's when, you know, it wasn't a big, you know, being a gay athlete coming in, when he made that big deal, it was like, oh, my God, all the LGBT community was going to be outside of Park Avenue, and they were going to go crazy. So the NFL make that call to Jeff Fisher, like, y'all St. Louis, he went to school there, he was cool with it, please draft him. They draft him. But then when they draft him, they go sign Ethan Westbrook, and they gave Ethan Westbrook a $50,000 signing bonus. For people that's in the league that knows, you don't give free agents $50,000 signing bonus unless they guarantee to make the team. At the time, the Rams had their best pass rusher ever. They had
best
like Robinson,
D-line
all
in
them
the
dudes.
League.
And they went
no
and signed Ethan Westbrook, and I
can
knew that they wasn't going to play.
He wasn't that good to begin with.
What I'm saying is that the league makes decisions based on their own business to save their own business. So they needed somebody to basically take that step to basically secure them so they didn't get looked at a certain way. Right. That's what I'm saying regarding all these things.
Hold on, I'm not trying to cut everybody off, but damn it. JaVale, get on what you was going to say, because I got to hear this shit. He been waiting. Y'all just not let this talk. Oh, JaVale. It's been a long time since JaVale called in. Y'all messing
with
me. Yeah,
he on the helmet today.
Nah, man. I chimed in, and when I chimed in, I heard he made the comment about him, Mahomes being black and white, and that was a factor of him getting the contract. So
I have a question.
I'll
be that guy.
Wait, what? What?
Okay. Okay.
But I have the issue. I have the issue with it always has to come back to race, and that's my issue, because all of the top quarterbacks in the league right now, with your exceptions of the older generation and your Brady and your Breezes and you know what I'm saying, and that echelon right there and Aaron Rodgers, all the best quarterbacks are black. I'm tired of hearing about the race, and they don't get the opportunity, because all the best quarterbacks in the league right now are black men. All of them.
Hey, man,
so
that's real
back
that,
in the
you,
day, too.
You,
like
you,
Warren
you
Moon.
Seem real, like, you seem real emotional about this topic, but you feel like it's insulting to bring it up. We're going to see what these guys get paid going forward. We're going to see if they're treated like franchise quarterbacks and so-called faces of the league. I got doubts on whether that will happen or not. Hopefully it does.
They don't have
now,
a choice.
Say,
they don't have a choice,
hold on,
bro. They don't have
on,
a choice.
But,
Jerry Jones,
bro,
Jerry Jones don't want to pay that,
why
but
are you
he has to.
I get tired of the same shit all the time. You get tired of it. You get tired of it. Now I'm going to ask you one simple question. If somebody is not the upper echelon like you just talked about, are they going to be holding the clipboard? Are they going to be the third quarterback? Are they going to be having a route to be the QB coach, then OC, and then become a head coach? See, these are actual problems, man. This ain't about your emotion. This is a real thing. Look up the Fritz Pollard Alliance and read some of the stuff they put out over the past few years. They've been documenting this stuff for decades. This ain't no emotional thing where you say, well, we got some double
draft
before it's all over. It's like, nah, bruh.
Cam Newton, Jameis Winston, again, they don't have to do anything. That's why, again, the reality of how it went when they talk about contracts, the Patrick Mahomes contract, which you wasn't on earlier, he got $140 million guaranteed, but a $503 million piece of paper. I just broke down Kirk Cousins, who was no way near Patrick Mahomes' caliber, but at the same time, Kirk Cousins' contract is going to exceed his within a year or two, and so is Matt Ryan. And so is Aaron Rodgers again. So
and
even though
so is Tom Brady and Drew Brees, both 43 years old, both got $25 million guaranteed, and Cam is out here on a hope year.
That's my point. They don't have to exactly right, and way younger.
So if you can't
they
do that, bro, I don't know what to tell you.
So why can't it be that they are paid on their career and not just what they did last year? Because at some point,
the NFL is paying on career.
I've never heard the NFL operate like that. I've seen the NFL tell Joe Montana your key card don't work here no more.
You got to go. I've seen them tell Jerry Rice your key card don't work here. You got to go. Steve McNair, your key card don't work here. You got to go. I've never heard the NFL paying for past performance of an aging player. Never.
But
if you can still, at the quarterback position,
where you can play longer than any other position,
I'm just trying to get all aspects because you're not giving all aspects. I just gave you five examples.
I understand.
Phil Rivers to go find a new team,
and he did. So it's what it takes is one out of the 32. So,
to your point, it's a good thing that Dak Prescott is doing what he's doing. But like I said again,
it's a great thing.
I said that before, but what I'm saying is as great as what Dak is doing is when they basically promoted Patrick Mahomes because from a business standpoint, like I said before, all thing encompassed, Patrick Mahomes made the decision that he wanted to do it for the team. And I'm not knocking anybody that wants to say I want to win Super Bowls, things like that. But from a business side, which again, in football, is a physical game. That contract that he signed, Aaron Rodgers is not signing. Matt Ryan is not signing. Kirk Cousins is not signing.
Because they're not 25.
Dak Prescott is not signing either.
Dak Prescott is not signing either, though.
That's my point. Dak Prescott could have took a $10 million, 10-year deal. Zeke took an eight-year extension, which made it 10 years.
Robert, check this out. Dak is smart about that. Well, Robert, check this out. To me, if you break down the numbers and you break down the salary cap, to me that when you pay your these quote unquote franchise quarterbacks, when you pay them. You know, because what's the average? 30, 35 for top tier?
It's 30,
you know what I'm saying?
32, 33 right now, but it's going up.
Okay, so right, between 30 and 35. So if the salary cap is at 200, like if you can't pay one of those upper echelon quarterbacks or franchise quarterbacks that money, to me that's a poorly run organization. Because you think about it. That's only 30. You said 32, 33 million out of 200. You know what I'm saying? Because you're not gonna have all these high priced players. What the NFL organizations get caught up is that they look towards the future and they put too many options in the future. And then when things don't pan out, or if they want to cut a player, or if they want to trade a player, they still have to eat large sums of money
on that, his contract.
Yep. Well, you know they don't, not in NFL. They don't have
to. No, brother.
What
they
sign,
NFL
what
team
that signing bonus is done,
well.
Nothing else is guaranteed
they know, except for the years. No, no. Look, NFL teams understand that well. Everything he just said was true about salary cap and about QB pay and the rest of the roster. The issue is they're able to manipulate fans, and they know that by using what? Saying this guy is taking up all the money, that's why we can't field a good team, rather than saying we made some bad signings or we did some terrible things as an organization. Right. And fans are open to that.
Exactly.
That's why they use it. But real quick, just so everybody knows, what is a salary cap? A salary cap is an artificially way for owners to pay less and never have to actually pay market value for what players are actually worth. So always remember that with salary cap. NFL to MLB to NBA. Same
thing.
That's
why you get that. That's
the only
reason for salary cap. And then you play well, you get paid again next year.
I think because of the COVID and this whole situation, I think baseball is going to hurt from that more than anything. Because I think these baseball players in the next bargaining agreement, they would rather have a salary cap. Even though they have unlimited salaries and the structure of baseball, I think with this, we may see baseball going to a salary cap just like all the other sports organizations.
Hey, Javel, that's a great topic. So
if you see baseball players,
so baseball got 25 players, NFL got what? 53? 46 active.
Right.
46. And then but you get in the tiers, like the lower level guys don't get paid that much. Well, we do know the NFL makes more money, way more money from a TV advertising, gambling, merchandise standpoint than the actual Major League Baseball. We do know the NFL has more injury risk in regards to
in America.
Got it. But if that's the case, then why is it that those baseball players are making so much more money and is guaranteed than football players when the football players are bringing that way much more money in? Like I said before, 32 owners splitting 52% of the pie while 1,900 players are splitting 48%. That's bad representation.
Well, see, well, this one is easy. The MLB Players Union has actually won before. You go back to that strike in 94, they beat the hell out of the owners.
You're right.
That's an actual win that they have. Then the other part is length of careers. Baseball players play for a long time. And then, remember, they got global revenue. It ain't just the United States. The NFL is somewhat limited in that it's an American sport. While these other sports, man, I wish the NBA would open up its books on China. I know the players want to know. But the players
they get that money, though. The NFL get it globally, though. They don't play over there, but they get it from a TV advertising standpoint.
Not to the degree of these other leagues, though. They get it.
No, but I'm saying when he's talking about the bottom line about the money they bring in, Major League Baseball is not bringing in money like the NFL right now, but yet they still pay like they do. That's
well,
the
globally
part about
are,
it all.
That's what I'm saying. You go to Taiwan, South Korea, China.
I got you.
Like these people, you see what I mean? Like Tracy McGrady lands in China, it looks like, you know, the biggest superstar you can think of right now. Who is it? You know, Future or somebody landing in a stadium. Like, that's – and Tracy McGrady ain't played in what, 15 years?
Right.
Yeah.
right.
You know what I mean?
Let me bring it back. Let me bring the conversation back because JaVale said something that was true, but it had me thinking. So he talked about the African-American quarterback, how when you look at the NFL, African-American quarterback is the best quarterback. And you're not going to get an argument. But when it comes to money, are they viewed as the best? When you look at how the two African-American quarterbacks are better than all these other guys that were looking for the team, but at least compensated, does that still show what they truly think about them?
I think we're seeing
in our country right now has never been done before, and we have been moving in this direction. So I think that we've been through in this year of 2020 in the first 6 months. I think that's going to change the landscape of everything. I think that's going to change the landscape of everything. And there's a lot of people on the other side who are uncomfortable with the way we're moving and the way we're going. So I think, hell yeah, things are going to change. And Patrick Mahomes was the first quarterback who, at this time, was up for a new contract. As long as Lamar Jackson stays healthy, if he plays 14 out of 16 games and takes them back to the first, second round of the playoffs, he's going to get paid next year. You know what I'm saying?
Like Patrick Mahomes.
He should be paid even if he doesn't. But while that
he should, but he
was going
again,
on.
Again, who I said the most passing yards in the NFL last year? Everybody know.
Right. But while that Pat Mahomes thing is going on, Dak Prescott is going on too, where Jerry openly negotiated through the media, leaked details of track situation to get the fans against him, and now they finally had Dak sign that franchise tender. So that's going on too, bro. So
again,
the most passing
yards last year in the NFL was from a black quarterback. His name was Jameis Winston. Threw a lot of interceptions, but he still threw the most yards in the NFL last year. And he's a backup now to a guy at Drew Brees. So again, when you're making my point. That's the point I was saying to Javel before. It doesn't have to do with the most yards in the league.
I understand that.
It's
but
everything
if,
in
common.
Because Patrick Mahomes is everything.
If,
and again, that black and white thing, they make it matter.
It has to do. You cannot ignore that man's interception. I understand that he had the most passing yards. I understand his touchdowns. But if you're talking about wins and losses, that team was almost 500 with his interceptions. With his interceptions.
Right.
If he cuts down on half of those, that team makes the playoffs.
He's not the only man
that's,
ever threw interceptions that wasn't
and
the black
I understand
man,
that.
And
I understand that. I never said that. But you cannot ignore that. You cannot ignore that.
You're making the point I'm making right now. You see how hard you want him right now? That's exactly the point. So, again, the same quarterback like a Ryan Fitzpatrick who's still playing out of Harvard or wherever he came from.
No.
Do the same thing every single time, and
they
bring him back next year to start.
I can tell you what. There's two other quarterbacks. There's two other quarterbacks under Bruce Arians their first years. And Carson Palmer in Arizona and Ben Roethlisberger, who also threw 30-plus interceptions their first year with him. Okay? So that just so happened to be Jameis's franchise, his contract year. Because, as I said, Carson Palmer and Ben Roethlisberger did the exact same thing as Jameis Winston did last year.
You're making his point.
That's the point I'm making, and that's why I said it is a difference.
He should have had better opportunities than going and signing to be Drew Brees' backup. And remember one thing, man. Guys like Jameis have always existed in the NFL, but there's always been coaches who said, I can be the guy to fix that guy. Carson Palmer's of the world. What did Hugh Jackson say? Oh, I can fix Carson. He wants to get out of Cincy? Bring him out here to L.A. I'll fix him. That's always happened. Jay Cutler had a 10-year career because
Jay
multiple
Cutler
coaches said
like
they were going to fix Jay Cutler. And nobody else did. And then
I agree with everything that both of you guys
said. So when I say he led the league
but
in
then,
yards,
but,
so that's what
oh,
I'm saying.
Okay,
so
but then,
about,
but then you,
black,
but no, 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 no. But then when it goes to performance on the field, and where you talk about the interceptions and other quarterbacks throwing the interceptions, then it goes to PR, and then it goes to off the field. Because off the field
matters. That's why I said Patrick Mahomes is black
and
Jameis, white. He's trying to save themselves.
Right. Jameis has had some issues that gives owners and GMs reservations, regardless if people want to admit that or not. He does. Just like if you want to play the race thing, just like a lot of GMs and owners were hesitant and
Blame
didn't want Johnny Manziel.
I'm saying it works the same way.
I'm saying
the NFL is a corporation. In the face of a corporation, they have made a decision that based on what happened with Kaepernick, based on what's happening now, that when that $503 million piece of paper was said, that wasn't just a Kansas City Chief decision. That was an NFL corporate, he's a face of our league decision. Because, again, if he's white and he's black, with well, the all issues that they got, they're trying to figure out, because Brady ain't going to be the front anymore, they're trying to figure out who could do that. And they had a choice. It could have been Dak Prescott. It could have been Cam before he started going all over the place with his clothes. Who knows? It could have been Deshaun Watson. But Patrick Mahomes, the league MVP, the Super Bowl MVP, and because of where he is and because of his, like I said, everything encompassed in him. But if you don't think that him being both black and white wasn't part of that whole thing, you're not understanding how the NFL thinks about their business.
That's
they talk about doing a black national anthem just to appease people for 1 week. This is crazy.
So basically the NFL has made, I think it's two. I don't think it's just Patrick Mahomes. I think Russell Wilson is just on a high level as Patrick Mahomes. Mm-hmm. So
right.
If Russell Wilson would have been up, Russell would have got that same type of deal.
Absolutely.
So yeah, Russell would have got.
And he's a mixed guy too. So therefore, the NFL is that their way of saying I'm not racist. Look. So he's trying to appease both their audiences.
Russell is an NFL owner and GM's dream. All he does is speak quarterback speak in interviews.
Right.
He promotes the team. He's clean living guy. Like,
yep.
Russell, they
want part of the
coaching
thing.
More Russells.
Eric
Good
Bieniemy,
Christian brother.
You ever heard Eric Bieniemy talk? Kansas City coordinator? Anybody heard him talk?
Good Christian brother.
Eric Bieniemy?
He is.
No,
he can be a good Christian brother, but from a corporate standpoint, we're talking about coaches getting a head coaching job and how they look at their corporate scenario, how you speak out front, they care about that.
Big dog, take them to the boardroom. Like, if they're trying to convince DirecTV or one of these other sponsors,
right, they're not going
to.
That's why Cam lost Oikos. That's why Cam lost everything.
Russell Wilson is the dude they want to walk in that room and talk to them about how they should invest in the NFL. Pat Mahomes is a dude they want to walk in that boardroom.
Yep.
Lamar, not so much right now. Like, Lamar's
Cam
gonna have
Newton
to be
too.
So much better than everybody to get the bread that
right.
those guys are going to get. Like, Lamar's going to have to be phenomenal on the field because he talks and acts like us to a degree.
It's a business.
To them, that's not as accepted.
I mean,
I got one question. Well, it's a two-parted question, but it's kind of the same. You don't think they do that on the other side as well? You don't think they would rather have Aaron Rodgers and Tom Brady and not Baker Mayfield? You know what I'm saying? You don't think they fat shame Andy Reid every time the Chiefs are on TV on national TV because they say he's too big. You know what I'm saying? You don't think people have a certain idea of what they want as these billionaires? I mean, I'm not saying anything you guys are saying is wrong.
This is what I'm trying to say to you. Everything has shades of everything in it. It's not so binary as this happens because of this and this only. There's all shades to everything. So, no, we're not saying that Baker Mayfield can walk into that same boardroom. No, the NFL don't want them representing him either. So, no, man, it ain't about that.
No,
it's all incompetent, and
Baker had a chance, so did Johnny Manziel, but they missed it.
Yeah,
so there it is. They move on to what's best for their business. And what's best for
right,
their business
see,
is Patrick Mahomes and
Russell
Wilson.
I don't want to hear what people –
because you seem real strident in trying to tell us, a league who tell us they have race problems doesn't have race problems. That's the weird part to me that you're doing today, brother.
Because here's the thing. That's what's pissing me off, because when you talk about – when everybody wants to bring up off the field issues and not want to give somebody big money, they paid Ben Roethlisberger and he ripped the whole person.
Yep.
That got swept under the rug. You know what I'm saying?
That's always been that way, man.
And there's people that like as far as like Jameis Winston, my brother went to school with Jameis. My family knows Jameis Winston. He does dumb things, but he ain't never did nothing like that. You know what I'm saying?
Mm-hmm.
And that's one of the main thing they held over him was crab legs. What, the first 2 years of his career?
No, that's not actually true. I'm sorry, I got to chime in. That's not actually true. This is a thing that happened in Florida State, but I don't even want to go into that right now.
Oh,
like
right.
Said,
okay.
While we talk about this,
okay.
Cover another topic since we're talking about race. DeSean Jackson's Instagram post where he was showing in the book what Hitler said about black folks in the U.S. and how the Eagles want to cut ties with him, but then praise some goddamn Riley Cooper for saying the N-word. Go.
I missed all that. So
we really
got to
get Riley Cooper sometime today. We really got to get Riley Cooper anytime.
No, I'm just saying how somebody's own words, they called upon my brother to step
up. Hitler never said man. It's a misquote from IG. DeSean is in a bad place right now.
Let me finish, bro. Let me finish. when it came to Riley saying the N-word, they asked my brother to step up to him and be a leader, which is Michael Vick, because his ass step up and have his, back, his ass go to counseling for like 2 days. He could. Deshaun may be in a bad place. Be an SMA. That's not his own damn word. He shared a thought from Hitler about the view of black, and he's being vilified.
What do you expect, though? It's double standard. So, again, he's talking about what you have to do in this business to maintain what somebody doesn't have to do. But we already know that already. So, truth be told, Deshaun, regardless of the fact, should have known what he was doing, what he was asking for when he did that. I tell athletes all the time. Like, think about it before you hit set.
Hold on. I'm not disputing that. You see what I'm doing. Because DeVille talking about race don't mean shit, and it's prevalent. It means shit.
It means something. I don't know what. Yeah, Javel, it means something. I'm sorry. The citizens is in, bro. It means a whole lot. Like you can come in and say certain things, and you can get away with it and joke and laugh, and I'm dealing with some of this stuff now pertaining to these colleges and NCAA. He didn't mean nothing by it. Like, nah, he meant everything by it. And the way you do those things, but when we do it, it become a big deal. But understanding that is like, you know, like I said, Riley Cooper said what he said and did what he did, and that was a time where, you know, he got away with it. But I would say today, like, despite who it is, Deshaun Jackson, somebody else, if it was Riley Cooper, to be fair, if Riley Cooper said it today, well, he'd have a whole lot more hell to pay than he did back then. So if that means anything, that's progress.
Ain't no way to defend Deshaun here. Deshaun was dead.
I'm
wrong.
Not defending him.
He was
I'm
dead.
Not.
No, I know you're not. Yep. I'm just wrong in general. ain't no way to defend Deshaun here. He was dead wrong. He quoted some inaccurate stuff. And then on top of that, it's like, dude, why did you think he wanted to quote something from Hitler anyway if it was correct? Like, what is you on?
Did he quote it?
Isn't that beautiful? We can say that he was wrong and then say, you know what, you need to be better, but yet the other way around, that never happens. It's always an excuse, a justification.
No.
I'm talking about from the other side. So when we can say this about Deshaun Jackson, we're right. Like, he was wrong. But what I'm saying is, if it happens the other way around, it's justification for the reason for it. It's a it was a misunderstanding. You took it out of context.
Hold on. You can't share what's in the book.
That's not in a book. It's an Facebook, Instagram meme that's inaccurate, like the most, like the majority of memes. This dude goes and reposts it. The team is owned by a Jewish dude, and he's seeing this anti-Semitic stuff on IG from his wide receiver. Now people are putting pressure on him to fine or cut Deshaun, and we'll see what the punishment is. But Deshaun did wrong on this. Just because other people are hypocrites and will try to justify stuff don't mean we got to. Deshaun was
exactly.
Right.
No. See, that's that Nat Turner shit that he was talking about. We always take the high road. Oh, no, which is wrong. We always accountable, but they ain't never held accountable. That's my state. That's what gave me frustrated. See how quick we just
right.
You're
right, and that's why I'm trying to hold people accountable now too on just regular stuff.
No,
like, but that's the point. You got to point it out.
All right, Hope. Next time you see the black Hebrew Israelite downtown yelling at people on the corner, I want you to go talk to them, Hope.
Stay there. No. I'm not laughing. Stay here because we always do that.
Because I ain't talking to them brothers.
We do this as black folks. We do this. If we hold ourselves accountable, you can't do that. But we don't do that. On the other side, we don't. I'm just putting it out there. Like,
I think we do. I think we hold their feet to the fire, but we ain't the ones with the power to hire and fire.
Here's the thing that's frustrating right here. Y'all, you take me discussing this and saying, what's it really that bad? You can't defend that. You're not defending it. I'm comparing it. It's a difference if I say, man, the client did it wrong. That's me defending it. I'm just saying, something said. Yes, it was insensitive. You got to do his own. Hell yeah, it's going to be repercussions.
But
here's what they think.
Yeah, we're doing that thing that they do. We're saying
that's crazy.
And saying what he said was racist. And
I wasn't
making the Riley Cooper connection. You making the Riley Cooper connection. So if we're making the Riley Cooper connection, yeah, this shows the hypocrisy.
Okay,
and the fact that they made Michael Vick
always
his
part of sports. That's the whole point.
Yeah, Nick Bosa is
dead
wrong too.
The money is a hypocrisy. It's always been like that.
So I'm just tying it all in. That's all I'm doing. I'm getting, you know, it ain't like no attack on y'all. It's just we get all the viewers and the listeners, everybody, like,
I get what you're saying. So to your listeners, I'll say this. Remember when y'all mad y'all about DeSean Jackson? Remember how like not mad y'all were when Riley Cooper did what he did? He was just out there with his friends. That's how you get him from that standpoint. Like, I don't want to hear your thought process opinion now when it don't really go in the direction where you feel like it's your voice being heard. And then basically somebody went to
Riley
your
Cooper
voice.
Found
that's
one
that's
person
the
at a Kenny Chesney concert and called him a nigga. Like, think about how racist you got to be to do that.
Hey, Vaughn said something interesting. I don't think a lot of people caught when he talked about LeBar. That's true, but people don't want to talk about. Vaughn said,
he's comfortable.
Because Lamar talked like us. You got to make sure X, Y, and Z. That's a true statement.
It is. That's what I said about Eric Bieniemy from the Kansas City offense coordinator. I said, y'all ever heard him talk? He was like, why he ain't get a head coaching job? I'm telling you why. Same way, have you ever heard Tim Hardaway talk? You hear the killer crossover, you hear him kill a speech.
Tim Hardaway, man, I'm going to start laughing. Not cool.
Yeah, he got that killer crossover, but he ain't got that killer speech. Ain't nobody about to have him write no speak, do no, what do you call it, graduation ceremonies. No.
Meanwhile, on the other side, Freddie Kitchens, who ain't never put together a full, complete sentence, didn't take over a head. David Cooter. What was his name in Detroit, that OC name
in Detroit?
Cooter something.
I guess, Javel, you made our point again. It is about race. Because that would be about the equivalent. I take that back. Eric Bieniemy should have a job if the standard is Freddie Kitchens. Yep.
You're right.
a question.
Think about this.
Because
you will never see anybody black as incompetent as Bill O'Brien ever walk around with two hats like that. You will never see that. I'll tell you that right now.
That is crazy. That was gonna be my question to you, Rob. I said Lamar, but also I wanted to bring up Deshaun Watson as well too. But I think he's kind of stuck in a rock and a hard place because of Bill O'Brien. Bill O'Brien
I think
probably
stuck in a rock and a hard place because giving away his receivers. But now at this point too, again, the NFL is a business. So regardless of how we feel about who's the best player, or whatever, because it is business, they have a certain amount of diversity now, or if you want to call it black representation. If you talk about Russell, now you talk about Patrick Mahomes, man, there ain't too much more room they're gonna have for that. So it's like, Deshaun might be the one that's outside looking in after Lamar. And I feel bad. He's gonna end up being like that Warren Moon type of career. Like, man, he's really good.
Yeah.
But you really didn't know, because
even if he gets the bread, the team is gonna be so terrible that he's gonna be
blamed
for the losses.
Like,
Bill O'Brien gonna be
like,
fired by then, and they're all gonna say Deshaun Watson's not a winner. But that's still
only 2 years though. Once his contract up, they can only franchise him 2 years. So if they want to be willing to pay him that money, he can get that money for 2 years, and then he'll be a free agent. Why can't he go that route?
Would you want to play franchise under Bill O'Brien?
I mean, he can't control that. He can't control that. He can't control if they franchise him. He can deny a contract if they want to extend him or offer him a new contract. He can say no.
He can do what Dak's doing.
I'm about to throw a log in the fire. Who's going to be the first African-American quarterback to pull a Kirk Cousins?
It could be Deshaun. If he really wants to be there, I would think it's going to be Dak Prescott.
They're going to max out Deshaun.
He's just going to be there without a lot of talent. And don't forget, Bill O'Brien traded away a bunch of their early picks, too.
I'm going to make a prediction.
Next 2 years.
Dak Prescott do 2 years with the Cowboys and he's going to the Steelers.
If I'm Deshaun, I'm running like hell.
You ain't hear about it said? Because I don't want
to
make sure I heard Lamar. So,
to the Steelers after 2 years?
After he do 2 years franchise, Jerry, he going to go and get paid.
I thought the Steelers is who Cam should have signed with, for real.
Yeah, I'm trying to tell you. That's going to get
Big Ben's agent would have set that building on fire if they tried to bring Cam in there. That's just the reality of a veteran.
I mean, but Ben only has 2 years left at the most, though.
Cam's only 34. I think he's done now, but I'm just saying he's on the roster now.
Yeah.
They're planning on starting.
Right.
His agent are not letting him bring Cam in. Like, dude would have had a fit.
I've
never
bring
a player to you guys. That would have been a fight.
If you know the Cowboys roster right now, Jerry just paid
a
wide receiver. He paid Ezekiel Elliott. If Dak don't take this team-friendly deal like Patrick Mahomes did, there's nothing that he can do about it. They won't win, and he's going to get paid regardless. That's why I said he's going to be the next Kirk Cousins, because then he's going to be able to go with the face of the Cowboys with him wherever he want to go. And he's probably going to go somewhere like the Steelers, because, again, at the end of the day, that's a big program and things like that that he can do things with. So, bottom line, Patrick Mahomes is a screwed Cowboys. Dak Prescott, again, all the stuff that they said about him being close to a deal, he never should have did what he did. He did it right. Get the franchise that. They're not trying to give him real money. He didn't want to sign
right.
the six-year deal, the fifth-year extension, would have made it 6 years. Why would he want to do that? Again, every year, there's really a one-year deal. I'm a quarterback.
Mm-hmm.
You want to lock me in for 5 or 6 years. Why is it so important to the Cowboys? Because you could turn around when you got me in a year and tell me I got to take a pay cut and help you sign the next wide receiver. I'm not doing
yeah.
that. And so now he didn't sign it.
If you take a girl to Popeyes all the time and then one day she says she want to go to Papa Do's, you might feel a way about that. And that's what you're saying with Jerry. Jerry should have just paid this dude the full boat. Like, there's no reason not to pay Dak. And now all the stupidness he got into with him. Well, true. True. But
everybody says
that
Jerry pays plays. He don't pay plays. He let you fail.
Yeah. But we're still talking about NFL money. You
yeah, that's what I'm saying.
Deal,
oh, you got to pay anybody. Greg Hardy, Randy Gregory.
Yeah,
Michael Irvin still working to this day because he ain't get paid. Troy
yeah.
Aikman, the same thing. Jason Witten. He got rich by getting players to take that quote-unquote American team spiel and never win nothing.
Mm-hmm.
And keep it moving.
He should have got his money.
I ain't got to say nothing bad about the Cowboys.
How you going to pay a receiver and a running back before you pay the quarterback? It's crazy.
Here's what they think about.
Zeke to sign an 8-year extension at running back and then going to tell Dak to take 6 years as an extension.
Mm, yeah.
So he's saying the new chip has got to be the dumbest dude to walk the face of the earth. So if I can get these dudes to basically just give me all these years, a little bit of money, I'm sitting pretty.
Yep.
One took me.
Like I said, I call it the Scottie Pippen. Sign this long-term deal for security, and eventually you won't be making market rate, and you're going to be mad.
Now y'all see why I ain't feel bad for Scotty. I'm sorry. I didn't feel bad.
But look at that situation. We got the Steelers I mentioned. You got the Colts is possibly coming up. You even got the Saints if Jameis don't get right. He got a bunch of teams. If he just plays okay over these next 2 years, if next year's franchise is like $40 million, not because they didn't get him signed from there. And then again, somebody gonna have a lot of money to spend. He's gonna be a guy that won a lot of games, down interceptions, and that's how he's operating business. He's going in about 1 year at a time. If he's stuck, he ain't gonna get paid regardless. Not no real.
And if he don't perform, it's on him. You got CeeDee Lamb, Michael Gallup, and Amari Cooper.
That's the point.
So
he's betting on himself for sure. He's betting on himself. Just like Kirk Cousins did with the Redskins. Bet on himself.
They loaded on offense to defense and mediocre.
You don't get no real money guarantee when you say betting on yourself. Who bet on himself and then lost? I'm talking about real money.
But he's looking at the franchise tag aspect and that quarterback. That's what you want.
You want to vilify the franchise tag. I'm like, give me all that guaranteed money up front now.
Yeah, that's
right.
All that's,
I do is do all right again I, next year. Give it to me again.
You said it a different way.
Don't read this out.
That's why I said Revis. That's the whole point. Revis is the perfect. Revis running around and nobody saying his name because he basically took the NFL with a kid that was like a 19-year-old agent and nobody even knew.
Oh,
I think his name was Zach. Without a kid.
And who was Revis's OG? Used to play for the Rams. Had contract problems with the NFL. Ran the NFLPA for a couple of years, and then showed Revis the way when he got there. Like. I can't think of his name, but y'all know who I'm talking about.
Sean Gilbert.
So there you go. So the media is going to talk about, oh, yeah, he signed this big paper deal. Oh, he don't want to take the franchise tag. No, that's exactly what you want. Because the franchise tag makes the salary cap hard for the team.
Hey, question, fellas. Question. Hey, so since it came to light over the past couple of days that everybody always thought or assumed that Daniel Snyder owned 70%+ of the Skins, right? So he actually only owned 40%. I mean 60%, and the other 40 was by minority owners, including my man who run FedEx. Okay, so that's where the whole name change thing came from.
You trying to get to talk about
Daniel
Snyder? Not be slick.
JaVale, we don't care about the
Redskins,
Hold on,
this is the hottest topic in the nation right now when it comes to sports.
Think about what he just told y'all.
About the Redskins, we just give him a hard time about the Redskins. You're right, but we can't let you.
I know about the story.
So check this out. So he only owns 60%, which nobody else ever knew until this weekend, and the other 40% is by minority owners, and they came and pressured him into changing the name, and they said they wanted to pull out of the naming rights and the sponsorship. So either find other investors, or if he has the capital to just buy those minority owners out, or does he just go with the name change? And the big word is Red Tails. Warriors. Would you guys feel upset, or would you guys feel that they were just doing this because of the time, because of Red Tails? Because that's basically what it's going to be, either Red Tails or Warriors. But there's a lot of folks, especially on that side, that Daniel Snyder invested money into the Trump campaign, over $1 million. And if they go Red Tails, you know what I'm saying? Would you guys applaud that, or would you just say Snyder's just doing it because of the time and the atmosphere in the country right now?
Everybody's doing everything for the time and the atmosphere. That's what business is. You go with where your money is paid. That's what they always do. That's what I keep telling people. They're going to go with the black quarterback because everybody likes the black quarterback now. They're going to go with Black Lives Matter like Coach K and Duke. You ain't been saying that. You ain't even helping Zion right now with his freaking deal. You let him sign his marketing group.
Hold on. Hey, Robert, I disagree with that. When you specifically say quarterback, Daniel Snyder has, from Jason Campbell to Donovan McNabb, he has given Robert Griffin.
You know
he has given
he
the black quarterback
at,
chances. But I'm talking about at this organization. This organization has probably had more starting black quarterbacks than any organization in the history of the NFL.
Yeah, because it's a black community. That's how you sell tickets.
And that's not saying a lot because we still got franchises who've never had one. But the main point is that's a leverage. Okay, we get you understanding. Just let me say something real quick. That's a leverage play from those other owners. They see Daniel being squeezed. This is their opportunity to either push him out or get a huge return on their investment and Daniel buy them out. But no matter what, this should have been done 20 years ago. It's a slur. Redskin is a slur. St. John's changed 20 years ago. You think people care that St. John's has a new name and a new logo? No, they bought new gear and they kept it moving. The same thing the Washington fans are going to do. They're going to buy new gear. They're going to get behind the new team or the idea of the new team, and they ain't going to be
no big deal. Red Tails, they're going to sell Black Lives Matter. So, when you talk about business owners, they don't have no feeling one way or the other.
But just so everybody knows, go back to 1600. You can read newspaper accounts from the Midwest, Minnesota, Illinois, Indiana, Ohio, and you'll see bounty for Redskin, meaning you would take the head of a Native American, have a little piece of skin on it so you could prove that it was Indian, and you got paid for it. So the idea that a team would be named after that is crazy. They should have been
good. And we had the owner who was the last owner to allow a black man to play on his roster.
Yep.
You know
John
what I'm
Preston Marshall.
So,
and at the brother's signing, he said, let the man play Dixie.
Hey, Hawk, let me get my little black history moment in since y'all doing yours. Let me get mine. So, in 1905, W.E. Du Bois, if you guys don't know who he is, the black patriot, and said, like, times like these, we're going to have equal rights, we're going to have equal equality and all these different things, which, again, led to 1909, which led to the Brown versus Board versus Education. What you don't know is in February 1906, there was this thing called Leavenworth, a prison, the first prison system that came out right after the slaves were freed, so they could steal a piece of cake and then get locked up for not understanding those things. Then they start working again. Literally, March 31st, 1906, a month later, came this thing that we know as the NCAA. Where now, again, when they talk about in jail, rehabilitation and reform, and in college free education, they've been giving out general education studies ever since, controlling everything you do or how you do it, and here we are today. So that was a way of, even though you were free, no, you're not free. We're going to put you in jail. We're going to put you in college chasing that star and that hat and that ring. And now here you are today signing contracts that are pretty much like toilet tissue. That's my point.
Yeah. That's hard right there, man.
But I'm just saying, it came literally a month apart.
We're going to have to see what Snyder do. It's going to be funny because Snyder's either going to buy them dudes out and they're going to get paid a lot because it's a fire sale. So he's going to have to pay them out a lot if they get out.
My man Bayos, because he bought his head corporation to Crystal City area. My man Scott, what's his name? Scott Bezos, right?
Jeff Bezos.
Yeah, I'm just saying, but he got the cash though, and he just came to DC. You know what I'm saying? So this will be perfect time for him to sell it.
That Pat Mahomes contract. The money that supposedly he's going to be paid, we all know he ain't going to see $475. Bezos made more than that during the pandemic from Amazon.
There you go.
Yeah, but he'll make that.
The pandemic, bro. Since Corona, that's how much bread he's made off Amazon.
Damn.
Oh, yeah. That's what I'm saying. It's like he got the cash for it.
Hmm.
And he just brought his headquarters to the like Springfield Chantilly shit.
Snyder would have to win still, and I doubt he does. He was a fan growing up, so I doubt he really
doesn't want to change the name. He really don't want to change the name.
Yeah,
oh, yeah, we know that.
You know what I'm saying?
It ain't just changing the name. You gotta change trademarks, you gotta build, you gotta get inventory, you gotta replace all that stuff. And
sound like a
they'll sell it. They'll sell
it.
The
real fans are gonna buy new jerseys.
Yeah, that's gonna be a positive. That's not gonna be a negative. That's gonna be a positive for the NFL.
Yes,
they want that. They want to push that right now over the next 2 months before
the NFL. But Daniel Snyder don't, because he has all that stuff that's already backlogged that he
right.
paid
but the,
for.
But when the other owners see that, man, and obviously a lot of people don't like doing business with them. Because if these minority owners want to get out of 40% of the NFL is the most profitable country club in our country. Why would you want to give that
club.
Up?
That's exactly how it's set up.
No, that was a good-ass point.
He's a country club.
But why do they want to give this money up? But, bro, think about Michael Jordan wearing 45 for that one season. Think about Kobe switching from 8 to 24. Jersey and merchandise from fans who are going to rebuy that stuff, dude. You like that money is stupid, bro. That's all winning.
That's what I'm saying.
Ain't nothing bad
so
about
you,
that.
You change,
matter of fact,
you change
Redskins
that shit
right
now.
Will be going
week,
online for high.
Yeah, you change
so,
it.
I mean,
next week and have 2 months to print that out. That'll be a cash cow, man. And
you
I,
know
I,
what?
I say,
it'd be such a cash cow. They'll change all that names and they'll still be trash. Really, look, man, I'm sorry. You're still talking about the Redskins.
You had to get that in there.
And you know what I'm saying? I'm starting to get annoyed now, you know?
I'm happy
y'all changing the name.
We weren't talking about the losses. I'm talking about the culture aspect, bro. That's all.
Oh, no, I got you.
You said your coach is losing, too. Golly. That's crazy.
But he's a Vikings fan, ain't nothing
more disrespectful than that Cleveland Indians logo. That was the most disrespectful. Like they had the Native Man cooning on
there. So that, but that's what I'm saying. Does everybody change?
Isn't it more?
Do Florida State have changed?
Yeah, I'm about to ask about Florida State. Then they're gonna be that.
Yeah, you know what I'm saying. So if the Redskins got to change, they got to change. And San Diego State, they can't be the Aztecs.
I don't know because the Seminoles have a relationship with Florida State. The ones in Florida, they got a relationship with them. So I don't know.
Florida State gonna be. That's gonna be kind of hard.
What about the hockey team? The hockey team in Chicago, the Blackhawks. Oh no.
Hold on. You're using examples that are not slurs. You can say that those teams are honoring those teams with the logos and stuff. You can never say Redskins is honoring somebody. Blackhawks, Seminoles, that's what they are. That's what those tribes were. They're not denigrating them in any way. You see what I'm saying?
Mm-hmm. That makes sense.
Right. So I gave the analogy to Aztec. That's the Aztec tribe is what you're saying. That's not a slur. That's who they are. They're people. They're community.
That's why the Redskin thing lasted so. It was crazy that it lasted this long, man. It should have been gone.
Gotcha.
Well, look, man.
But I'm thinking that's the whole point of the whole statues and things too. Is like things are there for that reason to keep people remembering those things and trying to keep them in place mentally. Like it's like this for a reason. So that's why some people are tearing down statues now. Because of those same type of scenarios, like so, the Redskins is like think of that name as another statue that somebody trying to rip down, like you know. So there you go.
Well, man, look, I appreciate
shout
everybody.
Shout out to
the
young folks. They said they ain't take a certain amount of disrespect. Period.
Hey,
they told that.
True.
Shout out to the young.
Why they talk about the young folks in the skinny jeans? They sure gonna make sure they ain't standing. Well, they can't stand. They ain't so skinny, but you do what. Hey, man, but any last words before we wrap this episode? It's been
we're
going
to boycott, so we need to boycott the skinny jeans. I'm sorry. I can't
boycott
do it.
The skinny jeans. Russell Westbrook will have something to say to you about that, boy.
Yeah, that's all right. Yeah, he can do that.
Hey, so my last word, Hawk, hey, as we going into the next week and a half, 2 weeks before the sports starts back up, is there any way that these leagues start back up and then sit it down because of
definitely.
Cases,
I think basketball.
Oh, they're gonna ride. They're gonna ride with it.
Oh, if the NBA kick off their season, you know it was guaranteed college football gonna return. Like NBA, with it was like they gonna kick off. Man, look,
you got a lot of guys that are dropping out on that though. Like,
yeah, they are. But LeBron,
they not rocking with it.
LeBron,
nah,
yeah.
But all the players who think their team have a chance of winning are playing.
Yeah, LeBron.
It's only.
I'm jokingly saying it, but it's the two. The face is playing. You know they're gonna use it, like, but LeBron playing. You know they saying that.
To that point too, COVID-19, in which I say all you guys, you know, y'all keep watching sports, and since I've been on this show with you guys, I'm like, look, I'm gonna say it again. Sports is not a game. Sports is all business. Business first.
Yeah.
That's the decision that's gonna be made. 1,000%, whether you like it or not. That's how it's going to go. That's why I try to teach these athletes and the people that listen to fans, like, every decision made is behind a dollar, period. And it ain't your feelings. And if the dollar says go this way, black quarterbacks to the front, then that's where they're going to be. If they not, then they're going back. And that's how it's always been. That's how it's going to be. So if you talk about money, oh, yeah, it's going to be sports because people need to go ahead and basically gamble and bet and pay their bills and get away from their realities. And if that costs some college kids their lives and their grandma their lives, trust me, the NCAA could care less. That's why I keep fighting the fight as the players rep, because they'll tell the players that sign waivers that are really – they're waivers, but they call them pledges. Are we just pledging? What the – is this second grade? I pledge allegiance. This is
like
the garbage that I've been dealing with on a regular basis.
Yeah. Don't be surprised.
Go ahead,
Vaughn. Go ahead.
No, I was going to say, like you said, it's about business. So every league is going to make their best effort and try to have a season. I don't think all of them are going to finish. We may see a couple of these leagues start off and go for a couple of weeks and then end up having to shut it down. Because this is a monumental task, man. Like I said, y'all remember the Cleveland Browns had staph infection in their locker room. They couldn't clear that out in one season. They had all kinds people get messed up by that. And when it comes to colleges, you see Morehouse already said they're not playing this year. It's going to be a lot of small schools that where it just ain't going to make dollars and cents for them to play, and they're just going to shut the team down.
Oh, and speaking of HBCU, salute to Maker for committing to Howard. People are, you know, pressing young African-American athletes to start trickling back to HBCUs. If you ever read the book, $40 Million Slave, you understand, you know, how it transitioned from African-American athletes HBCUs to PWI. So people have been, you know, on social media, been imploring that these young men and women, you know, attend HBCU. So that's dope, man. I always say college basketball was the easier transition to get that domino effect going versus football because there's so many moving parts. And you talk about facilities and things like that. But, yeah, I definitely want to salute him for that commitment.
How fine is this girl going to be as BMOC nationally at that small school? Bruh, that boy going to live a life. In that 1 year,
Oh man!
Party don't stop till you get there. Period.
Now, Darian, since you on here, man, your outro, your last words are your picks for Gnome 10. For anybody don't know, Darian's a huge fan. I'm a huge battle rap fan. It's a huge event, night of the main events coming on this weekend, free on caffeine. Get the caffeine at URL, the Ultimate Rap League. So what's your predictions this weekend, Darian? First, I'm going to give you Mike P and Saga. Who you got?
Mike P.
Okay. And then you got Geechee and Bird. Who you got?
Geechee 3-0.
Geechee 3-0.
Ain't nobody trying to hear that, Bird. Go ahead.
Oh, no, I tried to do that. The ultimate Madness finalist, Fonz and Jaden Nightwing. Who you got?
Jaden Nightwing.
We got Tay Rock versus Daylight. He returning. Who you got? Everybody's been doing that with
I'm gonna go with Daylight, man. People keep trying to kick for Rock, but I'm not gonna kick for him. So I'm going to stick with who I had originally. That's going to be Daylight. And I don't know if you've been hearing Daylight rap lately. Daylight is crazy with it. So,
it's been phenomenal.
Yeah.
It's been phenomenal.
Hey,
and then,
hey, what happened to Hollow, man?
Hollow is – he still battles. He still battles. He actually put – he put out an EP. What's today? Today the 7th?
Yeah,
today. He put out an EP today with like 5 or 6 cuts,
so,
I think.
What happened, long story short – He had a good battle with Lux as his partner doing the 2-on-2, but
yeah, he did.
The problem with Hollow died against Matt Hoffa, and we haven't seen that same Hollow since.
And he allowed it though. He allowed it. Like, no,
yeah, I would have never took that battle.
He didn't want to go hard pause. He didn't want to really beat Matt. He admitted it. Even though I think he died, period, because Matt just had so much pain in his pen, you could hear it. It would have been hard to beat him that night, in my opinion, because he just had so much pain. Almost like Bill collecting Hitman. I got Hitman winning, which I can understand why he's still winning, because he had so much pain and so much information to say in his bars that everybody was like, I want to hear him. You know what I'm saying? So
Hitman punched his head off,
That plays a role with Daylight and Tay Rock. I don't think people really want to hear it. Everybody be like, all right, Tay Rock, we heard you. Let's hear Daylight. You know what I'm saying?
See, man,
I ain't been listening to this
in a minute. Now, y'all got me back into it that quick.
Yeah, bro. Download the app. It's free. It's going to come on at 4, I believe. 4:30.
4 or 5. I think it's 5 o'clock.
Then the main event is Sue Surf and Lux. And I don't see any way that Lux is going to. I think every battle rapper is going to, like, gas Surf up. That it's going to appear that he's going to win in the building. I'm just saying that now.
It don't even matter. Nah, you're going to get that old Lux. That old Lux going to be barked on.
But you see what I just said? The folks don't want Lux to shoot Surf. Surf is like, it's almost like Swamp and Twerk. They really wanted Twerk to win, but he choked.
Hey, but the real, but the thing is though, like I said, the real always beats the fake, And like I said, when it came to Swamp, I think he kind of made his respect. It was the same way that happened with Kayshawn and Geechee. They was gassing Kayshawn out the building. But Geechee was like, yeah, they was bouncing off all those, you know what I'm saying? All
yeah,
everything was
true.
Just bouncing off them.
So, that's why Saga
beat I got Beloved though, man.
Saga beat B-Dot. He came to that third round. When Saga came to that third round versus B-Dot, ain't nobody got real name and he played football and stuff. I was surprised.
Oh,
nobody.
Yeah, I looked it up. The article, they say he was actually good too.
Nice, yeah.
Yeah.
So if you
real good.
Man, if you don't mind spending $8 a month, URL app definitely worth it, man. The battles they've been sharing and putting up there because they don't put them on YouTube no more. The last,
yeah,
I want to say.
Hollow died on RBE, so you can actually watch out on YouTube.
Watch that death. Yep. On YouTube, search Mad Alpha versus Hollow Vaughn, and you're going to be entertained by all the information that Mav shared with you. Like, you're going to be like, what the hell?
Like I said, I've been out for a minute. I'm in on it, bro.
Yeah,
like, I thought nobody could break down Hollow better than Lux did in that third round. Bro,
yeah.
This was worse.
The first battle you got to look up is Big K versus I-Boom if you want to be entertained. Just the first round. That's all you got to look at. Big K first. If you want to get back into battle rap and you want to have a good time, just look at that first round. No need to look at no more. It's the first. He go first, too. And you're going to be like, yo.
one quick point, though, I wanted to make real quick. Because we're all talking about the sports is a business. Key thing mm-hmm. about sports being the business. Who's on the front of 2K?
Mahomes right now. And then Lamar.
No, not Madden. Zion,
okay.
NBA.
Zion.
Who's in front? Zion is. Zion played how many games?
Oh, yeah. Zion going to be on it with so you got Kobe Edition, you got the Zion, and you got Dame Dollar. So, yeah, it's a business. Zion, you got to reach. Yeah. Yep. You on it.
Yeah. So my thing is, so Zion may play how many games?
He played what, 20? Did he play 20 some games?
20 some games.
Yeah.
How many did Ja Morant play?
I was about to say, they ain't even put the rookie of the year up there. That's crazy.
Exactly. That's what I'm saying. When you come to business, this is why sports is a business.
Now do season tickets for the Pelicans and do viewership for the Pelicans with Zion and do it for Ja, and everything makes sense.
Hey, Vaughn,
exactly.
You ain't have to do them. Don't crush their dreams that quick, man.
Shout
that, you
out
make
to
it too
Ja,
much.
Though. I like Ja.
Yeah, no,
shout out
to Ja, yeah. That market he in just not a favorable market either, you know. Sorry.
And Zion is a monster, so you got to market that dude.
Exactly. Zion a monster. He a monster. God, dog.
But you can say the same thing about Ja Morant, too, though.
Oh, no. Like we said, he in his own right, he's special, too. But,
yep.
You know, it's different. Some
yeah.
things just hit different, man. Balls hit different.
And never forget, he got famous on YouTube, so these people been watching him since he was 12 years old. Same thing going to happen to the ball boy when he get drafted number one this year. People that have followed his story from the beginning to the end, you know what I mean? You bring in a fan base with you day one.
God.
Yeah.
Okay.
That's something
man.
Else.
Yeah, man. But look, man, I appreciate y'all calling in, bro, man. This definitely was a dope show.
Appreciate y'all.
As always, great information was shared, great discussions. Y'all made me go against DeSean Jackson. That's some bullshit, but he messed up for what he did. I want to make that clear. Like, you can't. You even though, like Vaughn says, it's a meme. Like, fact check it, and yeah, you can't do that. As much as we want to have a discussion about it and debate, you really can't debate that. Like, yeah, you gonna get this smoke, DeSean. It just is what it is.
The owner of your team shouldn't get woke up at 2 a.m. saying you posted some anti-Semitic stuff and he Jewish. That can't happen.
Exactly. That's a smack in the face. That's a smack in the face. So, like I said, I try to get in my debate mode with Vaughn and them, but some things you just can't debate. That's why I was just like, yeah, let me go ahead and take this L and be like, yep, never mind. So, DeSean, yeah, bro. Yeah. You better get on that front line and get to that podium or something.
get Wentz to say something for you. I don't think anybody gonna tell
me. Apologizing like Drew Brees, bro. He gonna be apologizing like Drew Brees.
yo. Hey, Drew smoked that. Then he went at Trump like, come on, buddy. You know what I'm saying? In these last 48 hours, I was taught what everybody was telling me for 3 years, but in these last 48 hours, I got it. You know what I'm saying? 3 years they've been trying to tell y'all ass, but the 48 hours of heat, now you, oh, never mind. I understand now. I bet you do. Salute to Drew, man. But, yeah, man, that's it, man. Appreciate you, Vaughn, man. Have a good one, bro. Be safe.
Same, big dog. Y'all be safe.
My guy. Peace. So that's what we got, man. Appreciate y'all.